Starting with Gabrielle and the question about transparency in commercial arbitration, I wanted to ask you, and you know, sort of leaning on Ari's statement about the tail wagging the dog, it is a small minority of cases that potentially have a public interest involved in a arguably similar fashion than in more public international law disputes. But the majority of cases is in commercial arbitration, one where potentially the parties have a very strong interest in confidentiality. That's one of the reasons why arbitration has been chosen by the parties. This is what you can still read in every single arbitration book around the world, that this is one of the advantages of arbitration. So maybe you want to address this question of the confidentiality of the, you know, business transactions and business secrets behind that, just very briefly.
Thank you. I think that the point of how the ICC, for instance, deals with the issue, I think it's a good starting point. But there are other rules, and I'm referring, for instance, to the Chamber of Commerce in Milan, where if the parties, they don't object to the publication of the award before the award is actually rendered, that award is going to be published. There is, of course, the parties are not going to be mentioned in the publication and so on, but the award in itself and the content of that award is published. Now, at the ICC, we are working a different way. It's true, we are protecting the confidentiality of the interests, of the business interests of the parties. And the publication of the award is happens, A, if there is not a confidentiality clause in the terms of reference, or if the parties do not agree to any confidentiality during the proceedings. B, it doesn't happen soon after the rendering of the award. It happens usually 6 years after the award has been rendered. And we usually try to protect specific interests, such as military defense or other, I would say, IT disputes, etc. Some of these disputes are never going to be, or the awards on these disputes are never going to be published. And also there is a body, an internal body, that is going to review these awards, and they are going to accept the publication of these awards. Of course, no confidential information is going to be published, so the name of the parties, the name of the arbitrators, nothing is actually published.
And don't you think that sort of undermines the fundamental idea of transparency that you have so passionately argued for?
I think it might and it might not. Since I started at the ICC, I've seen an increasing number, for instance, of awards on disputes involving Arab Springs countries, for instance. And there, the issues involved in that proceedings are incredibly sensitive, and at the same time, they are incredibly linked to a public interest of that states, of two states. So that might be, and that was something that at the ICC, that there were people discussing about that, for instance, publishing in a few years, those kind of awards that might compose or together that might create a body of law that might help both the practitioners and the arbitrators to deal with these specific issues that the arbitral tribunals encountered during the proceedings involving Arab Spring states.
Moving along to Arif, and I'm not going to ask you to close your eyes, but I'm going to ask you a question about party autonomy, which you have so prominently put forward. Isn't party autonomy also the choice of the parties? And so if we give the option to the parties in commercial arbitration to have confidential proceedings, but maybe also less confidential, more transparent proceedings, then that is actually something that would very much be in line with party autonomy. And for instance, the example, the ICC putting out the names of the arbitrators on their website, the parties can opt out and the arbitrators can opt out. I can tell you none of my cases is on there. So isn't this something that actually allows for party autonomy?
Yes.
So I convinced you.
I'm easy. So, look, I mean, I think the answer lies, Maxi, in addressing the four or five components that of transparency. The first, I think, with respect to institutional transparency, they're the rulemakers, as I was saying. So the more information that there is out there with respect to how the rules are interpreted, how the rules that they're applied, whether it's a domestic rulemaking body or an international organization or institution such as the ICC and any of the others, I mean, I think that there has to be a significant amount of transparency there because it lends itself to predictability of the process. And I think that predictability of the process ultimately then helps with parties being able to have certainty as to the length and time and cost of arbitrations. I think with respect to the question of publishing the arbitrators' names, I mean, look, I'm a big fan of the ICC and Alexei is a great friend, but I really don't see the point, honestly. I mean, so you publish the names of all the arbitrators in order to allow for statistics to then be developed or for parties perhaps to do some analysis in order to see whether an arbitrator has too many appointments. But that arbitrator for whom you're trying to do the analysis may have five ICC arbitrations, four ICSID arbitrations, but I have no idea how many other arbitrations. So ultimately, when it comes to arbitrator transparency, it really is about the market force and whether ultimately arbitrators or parties are going to appoint arbitrators based on what it is that they address with the individual who's going to be arbitrating. If you're going to be my arbitrator, the one thing I expect you to tell me when I ask about your availability is how many arbitrations are you involved in and can you handle this arbitration? I mean, if you cannot be honest with me about that fundamental question, then we've got a bigger problem at hand, no? So, you know, I think that breaking these things down into what needs to be transparent is very, I think that's the critical question. And the answer to each of those elements of transparency leads to, I think, a different response. Most people, you know, when they talk about transparency, they talk about information access, you know, basic information such as where the dispute may be in the process, but also about access to the proceedings. And in the context of commercial arbitration, that's highly inappropriate. There is no public interest in anybody coming and walking into your and my arbitration and having a right to plead.
I think it's interesting because we're moving here almost into a ground where we have some, at least, understanding or common ground between the two of you. So it'd be interesting to see later on how that translates into your votes. But let's move to international commercial investment arbitration. And now with Samantha. And the question I wanted to ask you is, if you don't see that if we push the transparency, and I think we all agree that we need some form of transparency in an investor-state arbitration, we already have, with the transparency rules, a certain ground for transparency. But if we push that further, is there not a risk that we undermine really what the system is about? And that is having a cost-efficient system. So if we have too many amicus curiae and too many, you know, the tribunal needs to organize a hearing with, open court, is that not going to undermine the efficiency of the process? And is there not a risk, this is sort of the second part of the question, is there not a risk that we go back in time and sort of reminding us that at some point investor-state arbitration was created to depoliticize these disputes, so to get them out of the public discussion and to actually allow arbitrators to resolve the disputes rather than to have, you know, populist arguments and potentially even some military or other strong actions.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, there's clearly sort of competing interests and concerns at work here. And as with everything in life, it's about striking the right balance. But I mean, I think when we talk about, just to sort of work backwards in your question, when we talk about sort of depoliticizing the disputes, and that's why ISDS was set up. I mean, I think the concern there was really, you know, we're in a system of diplomatic protection, and an investor would go to the state and say, to its own state, so not to the host state of the investment, and sort of say, hey, look, like, these guys have stolen my property, will you please step in and help me out here? And they'd be like, oh, sorry, but we've actually sort of negotiating this other really sensitive thing here, so your little investment isn't actually of a huge amount of concern to us. And then the investor would be left without any remedy except for going to the national courts, which in just many situations wasn't an option that was open to them. And so when we talk about sort of repoliticising disputes, that's not what we're talking about. And what we are talking about is the fact that the disputes that we have now, and this is really about the system being a victim of its own success, we've moved so far beyond you stole my hotel, give me some money, into you have adopted an environmental policy that is to the benefit of your domestic population, and, you know, maybe it also affects sort of native peoples living on the land. And that's the sort of current politicization. And I don't see how a legitimate answer to that is, hey, sorry, but we decided to depoliticize all of this 50 years ago, so your interests have no place here. And often, you know, there's really not a sort of domestic forum for those interests to be raised, because the disputes are just not going forward in the domestic courts. And even if they were, you might end up with your sort of two competing decisions there. And I think I sort of, you know, I come back to like the first and the last points of what I said. Even if we all sat here today think to ourselves, you know what, this is all totally overblown. Really, ISDS, when it comes down to it, is almost like about efficient breach of contract. The state can sort of do whatever it wants, it just has to pay for the consequences. So why are we letting all these people in? Even if we all sat here and agreed on this, nobody outside of this room would think that that is a legitimate way forward. And ultimately, I think that is why transparency is just so vital, and so particularly vital at this point in time.
So my last question for Richard is, I think if I understood you correctly, you said that we already have a sort of basic level of transparency, and going beyond that would be unacceptable. What I wanted to ask you is, and sort of maybe building on what Arif said, you know, you trust the arbitrators. These are the guys and girls that you've chosen on your tribunal. Don't you trust the arbitrators as well to get that balance right, to potentially limit where necessary transparency? And you have all, you know, the possible limits, actually quite significant limits, in the UN Central Transparency Rules, for instance, where arbitral tribunals can, you know, step out of the, you know, regular transparent sort of regime of the UN Central Transparency Rules if they deem it necessary in the particular circumstances of the case.
I think that's right. I think that you have to trust the arbitrators to apply the new rules that we've got. I think that, as I said, what we have at the moment is enough. I don't think it should go any further, because otherwise it stops being arbitration and it starts being some sort of supranational investment court.
Arbitration.
Yeah, exactly. The point is, though, that I wanted to make is that you're quite right. You have to trust your tribunal to be able to apply that properly. But I think that a lot of the other measures which have been applied go further than is necessary to achieve some of the goals. And I think there's a danger that the baby might, or at least part of the baby, might have been thrown out with the bathwater.
So this is your opportunity to ask some questions to the tribunal before I will again ask you to vote. Yes, please. Could you just say your name?
Yeah, my name is Andrew Jericho from Aston University. And my question is to Mr. Arif Ali. Well, first of all, thank you for this interesting discussion. And I'm sure many of us would like to continue this discussion with you and Gabriel Riscala. But anyway, my question is about publication of arbitral awards. First of all, I need to mention that I voted against more transparent approach, and I'm against publication of arbitral award, because in my opinion, it undermines the most important benefit of commercial arbitration, which is confidentiality of proceedings for the parties. However, on the other side, there's a strong argument that proposed by policy development sector, policy makers, including academics, that it seems that in this state of affairs, large amount of commercial matters remains to be in the shadow then, and it's not available for proper analysis. Isn't this situation lead to a huge disadvantage to the idea of keeping the law in pace with the development of commerce? Because, you know, in this digital environment, global environment, many new matters, issues arise daily, and if they are still in the shadow within commercial arbitration, how could legislation be improved then? So my question is, how would you react to this argument?
I mean, it's a very, very astute and extremely good point, and I think you've articulated it really well. Look, at the end of the day, I think that when you look at most commercial arbitration awards, the points that are of the most interest and that are used by advocates and ultimately by, I think, by academics and for purposes of legislative reform are those that address procedural points, right? So, I mean, I do think that the publication of awards can only assist with those procedural points insofar as, or up to the extent to which the ICC or other organizations start to use those awards to be more transparent regarding the application of the rules or regarding procedure. But for the most part, the legal principles that you were just talking about, just before I say that, and it's those procedural points that then inform the discussion with respect to legislative reform of the law of arbitration at the seat of arbitration. So, I mean, that I think is something that can be addressed not with the publication of awards, but with the analysis of the awards and ultimately then being informing what it is that institutions are transparent about. But if you look at commercial arbitration awards as substance, frankly, there's very little that you're going to be able to get out of the award that's going to be instructive, even if we were assuming that there was a world of precedent in, let's say, in the sense of stare decisis, that you would be able to do something with it, because most commercial arbitration awards are fact-driven, and without those facts, the articulation of the legal principle is going to be in a vacuum and really somewhat useless. Now, the other point is that what benefit do you gain out of a decision on force majeure under Nigerian law if you were arbitrating a case under Australian law? Very little. So there's a procedural transparency that I can appreciate, because that creates a more developed piping for the substance of the system to run through. But I think ultimately the substance is so diverse that there's very little to be gained from substantive transparency.
That's
something. I just want to add a quick comment. It's true that most of the awards are dealing with they are fact driven, but I give you another example which contradicts what you just said. It's for a while there were cases involving parties under embargo, and that happens a lot in the ICC, and it's happening more and more. Now, I've been able to review some of these awards, who are actually very interesting, and they deal with, for instance, admissibility issues, which are, then we can say, we don't know whether it's procedural or merits or so on, but how the embargo affects the admissibility of a claim or not before an arbitral tribunal, that's very interesting, and it's not... It might be interesting for other tribunals as well. What I've seen, for instance, is that some of these arbitral tribunals are the same in different cases involving the same parties. They are just procedural, parallel proceedings. And they were referring their awards to the other case on which they took similar decisions. So that, I think, it's a typical example of how public international law issues should be interpreted constantly, or in a consistent way by the arbitral tribunals. Because can you imagine you have, for instance, an Iranian party before two different arbitral tribunals? They bring similar cases, similar claims. They are subject, that party is subject to a sanction, a UN sanction. We are not talking about a state sanction, we are talking about an international sanction. The arbitral tribunals take different decisions in the two different arbitral proceedings. This is incredibly inconsistent, and if we think about international arbitration as an international system of justice, as for instance the French courts have defined in the last decades, we cannot accept it. It's not even talking about public interest, it's talking about justice. And if justice is made differently, like in each case, well, there might be an issue of legitimacy of the conduct of the regime in itself, I think.
A couple of very, just two small points. One is that you may want to take a look at the decisions issued by the WIPO Arbitration and Mediation Center. I mean, it's not absolutely international commercial arbitration, but the WIPO decisions relating to the Uniform Domain Name Dispute Resolution Policy has led to a body of law relating to cyberspotting that has emanated out of what is effectively an international commercial arbitral dispute resolution scheme. So I think it's worth looking at. And the other thing, Max, maybe you were going to address this, was no one has yet really spoken about the costs of transparency. I mean, there's the principle of transparency that I think a lot of people would agree with in the context of investor-state arbitration, but you know, one of the comments that was being made, I can't remember by who, as to how it makes, what it is that arbitrators have to do. I think you were saying, well, what's the balancing act for arbitrators? So the biggest problem that I face as an arbitrator in investor state cases is how to implement the principle of transparency, no matter how much my soul may be bursting and my intellect wanting to allow for transparency. The biggest problem is who bears the costs of the four NGOs that want to participate. It's unfair for the parties to have to do that. When you decide to bring a claim against me, you do a cost-benefit analysis as the investor. I, in defending the case, do a cost-benefit analysis as the respondent state, right? But when those NGOs participate, they do so for free. And there's a huge free rider problem that needs to be addressed within the context of investor-state arbitration.
Samantha, maybe do you want to address that? It goes to
your
motion.
Look, and you have some very particular experience very recently, right?
I totally, totally take the point. And I think that, but you know, in commercial arbitration, I absolutely agree that sort of efficiency and cost effectiveness are two very important principles, and they're two major reasons why the parties choose that way of resolving disputes. But when it comes to investor-state arbitration, I mean, you can imagine one of these disputes going through a national court. You know, sort of the Keystone Pipeline going through the US courts. I mean, that would just be a sort of massive, sprawling litigation. And I understand that sort of arbitration is meant to bypass that a little bit, but when it is an arbitration that concerns these issues that a lot of people have a very real interest in, I think you have to sort of give cost effectiveness and efficiency less weight, frankly. But I mean, who should bear the cost? I mean, maybe there is a way to amend the rules that if you're going to intervene.
It's governments. No, I mean, I can't imagine a single investor that says, oh, I want everything to be transparent about whatever's going on. And when investors do, public relations firms are very helpful in that respect, and we've all done it as part of our advocacy. But I think to the extent that states sign on to the UNCITRAL regime on transparency, then perhaps there's a cost associated with that, because they can't impose the cost on us as on an investor. Well, then perhaps there is an additional transparency fee that is charged by the institution to subsidize the additional costs of that system of transparency that is being implemented. Because it's not fair on the private party.
Yeah. I mean, you can, to a certain extent, deal with it at the end in a cost award and say the investor had a totally bogus claim and it was necessary to have an amicus curiae actually addressing that, then potentially that is something and that can be addressed in the cost award, but of course it's more difficult the other way around. So I wanted to give you an opportunity to ask some more questions. I think we have one here and one here.
I just wonder, doesn't this discussion and sort of divergence between commercial and international investment arbitration sort of underlie the point that maybe investment arbitration has moved beyond a system of pure arbitration, and so that maybe we shouldn't keep trying to draw a checklist against the standards that we draw of what we understand as pure arbitration.
Mm-hmm. Can I, just in the interest of time, maybe collect two questions? I think you had one as well.
Yes, my question is totally different. I'm Stefan Kuchkov, a student for Mary. My question is, I think, mostly to the commercial arbitration speakers. In your opinion, how close is it from total transparency, which is on the way somehow, to de facto precedent system, not the euro, of course. I ask it because nowadays the experience and the arbitral awards and materials which we have are quite fragmentary and I think are not enough to show tendencies and trends in each and every sphere. But if more decisions, awards, I mean, will become transparent, it may, in my opinion, I may be wrong, result in the situation where arbitrators and parties in the course of the case will be researching everything and find out that in similar cases, in 70% of cases, it was decided in this way. So do you think it may result in precedent system, and if yes, what are the first implications?
And it's best answered by the ICC.
We review, we scrutinize awards every week, and I honestly don't see many reference as of today to previous arbitral tribunals awards. I think that the difficult task of an arbitral tribunal to refer to another award is that the law applicable might not be the same. And so the interpretation of a specific contractual clause under another law applicable might not be helpful for your specific case. But I think that the only significant examples on which I see this reference to other arbitral awards is when we talk about concepts that are a little bit higher than a simple than an interpretation of the clause. I see, as I mentioned, references in the embargo cases, in concept, in the definition of concepts such as the transnational public policy and all these kind of references. As of now, I don't see, and Wendy, I don't know whether you can confirm or not, but I don't see very often references.
Yes, that was the question.
Now, in the future,
the experience, the materials which we have are fragmentary, and you are right.
Yeah.
It's difficult to refer to another case, but imagine when cases become transparent, we will have millions of cases available, and perhaps classified so that we can navigate the massive data.
It also depends on how confidentiality will be applied by and how the publication will be applied by the institutions. I don't think that the ICC might, as of tomorrow, publish all the awards because parties may decide they don't want to, and we have internal policies that don't allow us to publish soon after the award has been rendered.
I think Wendy wants to add.
So it might take time, actually. The experience we had would suggest it won't happen. A lot of, Arif's absolutely right, what we see precedent or earlier cases cited, in, if at all, in ICC decisions is on procedural issues. And already, although cases aren't published with names, there is the bulletin regularly publishes anonymized case notes on decisions that deal with these types of procedural issues, interpretation of the rules. Potentially, that could broaden to the sanctions issue, which is an important, arguably, procedural issue. And even with that smaller body of precedent, we're not seeing a whole lot of cases cited. So I think the point Arif keeps coming back to, you know, almost 200 countries, there's an awful lot of governing laws, an awful lot of combinations of mandatory law, place of performance, governing law of the contract, law of the seat. All of these things make every single case pretty much different. The place where it might help is in the public-private partnerships and a privatization process, where, for example, Romania has multiple public-private partnerships, all governed by Romanian law, and certain public law issues interpreted there. It might be nice to see more consistency in those sorts of decisions. I don't think what I described solves that. But I think for the bigger part, we're not going to see precedent, certainly not the way we see in investor-state arbitration, where you really only have five causes of action, right? And they're all governed effectively, usually by the same law. Yeah.
Okay, Richard, you wanted to add something?
Thanks. I was just going to say, from the point of view of somebody who's a bit of a traitor to the arbitral cause, and I practice in the commercial cause as well, I wouldn't get too excited by the value of precedent. I completely agree with Wendy and Arif. It's, you know, the first thing you do is immediately find some fact to distinguish it from the other fact, and it really isn't much to get excited about, particularly the reasons we're talking in an international context. Turning to the other question, I personally wouldn't want to see investor-state arbitration move completely away from the world of arbitration. I still think that there is so much value in taking it away from, taking it out of a court system. And I think if we move too far, we end up with all the problems, or at least a lot of the problems you have with national courts trying to deal with these issues. Who appoints the judges? How many judges do we have? What's the seat? And I think, if I could argue, you know, slightly against myself, we've got a good system at the moment, but you didn't hear that. Everybody can vote for me.
I think, look, at heart, what is arbitration is a consensual system of resolving disputes where you get to pick the people who decide it. And as long as that is ISDS, it is arbitration. And the beauty of arbitration has always been that outside of those sort of basic fundamental requirements, you can kind of agree your way to any sort of procedural rule on any other topic. So I think it's, again, and it goes back to sort of balancing. So if we decide that in commercial arbitration, you know, once you've got in your consensual dispute resolution process, certain priorities are more important than others, and that in ISDS certain other priorities are more important than others, that's absolutely fine. But what you just have to maintain, unless we're just going to throw the baby out with the bathwater, is just the consensual nature of it.
So I think there are still many more questions that we can ask. What I would suggest is that we do so over a glass of whatever is going to be served in a moment, but we have a couple of other things to do. First of all, I think we should give our speakers a wonderful round of applause. And this time, I think we're just going to do commercial arbitration and investment arbitration because we've now heard in detail the arguments. So let me start again by commercial arbitration. Can you please show your hands if you are for the motion that we need an increased transparency? That looks like less than 50% to me. Just checking, can you show your hands if you think that we do not need more and increased transparency in commercial arbitration? I think that is the majority. So we've won the case on no further transparency. Now, investment arbitration, has it changed anything? There was a very large majority for more transparency in investor state arbitration. So I'm going to ask, who is against the motion that we need an increased transparency in investment arbitration? I think that is probably a hand or so more than we had before. Just tiny bit. So I take it that the rest of you, large majority, are still in favor of increased transparency. Yes, excellent. So one last thing. I know that Arif wanted to tell you something about a writing competition. But again, please put your hands together for a wonderful panel.
All right, folks. Well, you're going to have to put your hands together one more time. We have an inaugural Deckard International Essay Competition, for which about some 37 people registered interest, and then subsequently some smaller number submitted excellent essays, and those who did will all receive comments back, and we would like to continue interacting with you to help you advance the papers that you've written, and hopefully help you also find places that you can get them published. But on this particular Cambridge Arbitration Day, the winner of the essay competition is Lucia Vizikova. And so Lucia wrote a very nuanced, a very sophisticated and thoughtful paper on the question of what process is due parties in international arbitration. And hopefully we'll see that published at some point. But thank you, and well done. Congratulations. Thank you.
This brings to an end a very engaging discussion on the future of international arbitration, both commercial and investment. I think we can conclude today that while there are winds of change blowing, they're not necessarily strong enough to call for a radical change in the entire system. On that note, on behalf of the Graduate Law Society and the Faculty of Law of the University of Cambridge, I'd like to thank our moderators and speakers for sharing their insights throughout the day. I would particularly like to thank our panelists, Wendy and Arif in particular, as the only Indian PhD researcher in this faculty. I think it's important to engage in a discourse on gender and ethnicity diversity. And we've managed that to a great extent with the organization of this event, because we have 9 women and 3 men supporting this endeavor.
Wilma Hale, Deckard, Clifford Chance. I think I missed out a few. We had a list of eight sponsors.
Clyde & Co.
Arnold & Porter, Clyde & Co. Thank you very much to all our sponsors for the continued association in this project, and we hope to continue this in the future. Finally, thank you to the organizers for a wonderful event, and we hope to see you again in the coming years. I'd like to invite you all to the drinks reception sponsored by Clifford Chance outside.